Teachings of the Swan, Hamsa. Sage Sanaka and his brothers asked Brahma, "The mind clings to sense objects by natural affinity, and the objects are imprinted on the mind. How can the seeker of liberation escape from this bondage and reach the other shore?" Brahma was not able to answer the question from being engaged otherwise in creation. "I took the form of a swan and appeared in his front. The sages asked me, 'Who are you?' I told them, 'Are you asking this body, which is like yours, a modification of the elements? Or are you inquiring of the presiding principle, which is one in me, you and everything else? What significance is there in your question, which is immersed in ignorance? All these are only modifications of myself. There is nothing other than me. The mind and sense enjoyments belong to the body and not to the jiva. You must renounce both of them and contemplate on me, the Brahman. Sever your connection with the body, its modifications, the three states of waking, dream and deep sleep, and reach the fourth or Turiya. Dispel all your ignorance with the sword of wisdom, reasoning, advice of saints, the Shrutis, and get yourself seated in me, the Self, who dwells in your heart. The world is an illusion, a creation of the mind. The Self or consciousness appearing as the body, mind and indriyas is also an illusion, a superimposition on the Self. One must be fully absorbed in self-realization, even though the existence of the body is felt as hunger and thirst, etc. It is all like the cloth of a drunken man. On reaching the state of samadhi, the body, world, possessions, etc. cease to exist. All these are but a dream. Therefore, with even-mindedness and non-attachment, take shelter in me, the Self." After hearing this message, the sages praised and worshipped the Lord in the form of the swan, and the swan flew back. Uddhava, how is devotion greater than the other methods for liberation? Bhagavan, one who has fixed his mind on me by devotion and expects no reward finds joy in every part of the world. His senses and mind are under control. He has peace, has no likes and dislikes. He is Purna Kama. He is not influenced by objects. Devotion coupled with reverence purifies all defects. His heart melts. He gets haripulations. He gets tears of joy whenever he speaks or hears of my stories. He weeps incessantly or laughs, sings and or dances. He gets purified by calamities and sorrows. He shuns the company of women. Uddhava, please enlighten me on the process of meditation. Bhagavan, one must arrange a seat at a moderate height, not too high nor too low, with kusha grass, deer skin and cloth one above the other. Sit over it in a comfortable asana, the two hands thrown loose on the legs, body, neck and head erect in a straight line, gazing steadily on the tip of the nose. The senses must be controlled. Breath must be purified by puraka, inhalation, and kumbhaka, retention, and rechaka, slow exhalation. Slowly practiced, mentally chanting the pranava along with the breath, the heart must be aimed at. There, the enchanting form of the Lord must be mentally conceived with a symmetrical figure, gracious, charming looks, four long, beautiful arms, graceful neck, lovely cheeks, and bright smile. After observing each limb, the mind must be concentrated on his smile and should think of nothing else. The intellect must merge in him. By intense meditation, the body consciousness dissolves, the mind having dissolved in the Self. Bhagavan further dwelt upon Yoga Siddhis, the different avatars of Vishnu. the four varnas called Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Sudra. The four ashramas called Brahmacharya, Grihastha, Vanaprastha and Sannyasa, and their respective duties, devotion, spiritual knowledge, yogic discipline, Yama, Niyama, Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga and Sankhya, Prakriti and Purusha. The Great Truth, Bhagavan. The universe is a combination of Prakriti and Purusha. It is all the manifestation of one Brahman. There is nothing other than Brahman. So, one should not either praise or condemn others or their actions. One who sees the differences in others, that is duality, falls from pursuit of realization of Brahman. Out of Maya, the soul sees the illusion of the dream, and out of complete ignorance reaches the state of deep sleep, which is equal to death. So also, while awake, out of ignorance, duality is cognized as good and bad through the mind, body and speech, which is unreal. The Supreme assumes all forms. It is the Supreme that creates and gets created, projects and gets projected, destroys and gets destroyed. There is not a second substance. So this creation, sustenance and destruction are mere Maya appearing in the form of three gunas. With such ripe knowledge of Vijnana, one should move about in the world without any attachment. Uddhava, there is the body and soul. Which is it that suffers samsara? Bhagavan, the soul, out of ignorance, having contact with the body, senses and prana, suffers the pains and pleasures. The wise man of self-knowledge does not suffer anything. In the dream, where all objects and experiences are false, the dreamer suffers or enjoys as long as the ignorance of the dream continues. The man who has woke up from the dream no more suffers and knows that all the sufferings have been false. All sufferings belong to the ego, not to the self. The spirit identifying itself with the body, senses and prana is jiva, which suffers samsara. Once this ego sense is cut by the sword of wisdom, the soul is free and ever in the bliss of the self. To know the self and non-self by discrimination is wisdom. The self or Brahman is real, its consciousness. It's the fourth state called Turiya. The body senses, prana, mind, intellect, the ego and the sense objects are not the self. They are the products of matter, prakriti. I am the body concept brings on attachment to the mind, which creates passions, and so pain and pleasures are experienced. This must be cut by the sword of knowledge. The realized person is not aware of the body or its actions. He sees nothing other than the self. The self is ever directly perceptible. It is self-luminous, beyond birth and death, time and space. Because of its presence, all experiences are felt. The speech functions and the senses react. In order to obtain the state of self-awareness, one should control his mind and intellect and dedicate them to me. He should find delight in performing actions for my sake, remembering me always. He should seek the company of pious men. He should behold me alone as pervading within and without. He should see me in every person that he meets. There is no superior or inferior. He should salute a paraya, a cow or a dog. He must have the conviction that all created beings are only myself. Everything is Brahman. All actions performed for the sake of the Supreme are called Dharma. Uddhava received the above teachings of the Lord with full devotion and keen interest, went round Sri Krishna, prostrated to him, bathing his feet with the tears of joy for the teachings heard and tears of sorrow for the impending separation. And as per the Lord's instructions, he departed for Badrikashramam, performed great tapas and ultimately merged in the Supreme. After the departure of Uddhava, Sri Krishna went to the Darbar hall, called out all the members of the Yadava dynasty and said, "We are seeing great portents of destruction. This city of Dwaraka is going to be submerged into the sea in 7 days. Let us all proceed to Prabhasatirtha, worship the gods, Brahmins and cows for appeasement. Let the women folk be removed to Sankodara for safety." Accordingly, all of them left for Prabhasa. There they conducted great worship of the deity, cows and Brahmins. Brahmins were fed well and were given great presents. After the feast, all the Yadavas drank a very potent wine called Maireyaka, by which they lost all their senses. Soon they began to quarrel among themselves, which turned out to be dual battles, and everybody began to attack his neighbor, not knowing whether he was brother, uncle, son, or brother-in-law. There was not a soul who was quiet. They used all kinds of weapons, and also the grass stick grown on the seashore, which were like steel rods. The battle raged fierce, and all were wounded and lay dead. Balarama, seeing all this, left his mortal coil and returned to his permanent abode in the ocean of milk. Sri Krishna was sitting under a peepal tree, stretching himself in yoga nidra, one leg placed over the other. A hunter mistook the lord's foot for a deer's head and sent his arrow, tipped with the ominous iron piece. He came near for the prey and was shocked to find that the lord had been wounded by him. He fell at his feet and begged for pardon 1,000 times. Sri Krishna asked him to get up, told him that it had all been pre-planned by him, and directed the hunter to get into the waiting celestial chariot and proceed to heaven. Then Daruka, the chariot driver of Sri Krishna, came there. Sri Krishna bade him proceed to Dwaraka, report the loss of the Yadavas to his father Vasudeva and Devaki, and have them all removed to Indraprastha. When the driver was gone, Brahma, Lord Shiva, Indra, all the gods and celestials came there to pay their respects to Sri Krishna. As they were looking on, Sri Krishna bodily ascended to his original abode of Vaikuntha. The gods saluted him and returned. In Dwaraka, on hearing the news of the loss of Yadavas, Vasudeva collapsed and left his mortal coil. The ladies, including Devaki, Rukmini and all the others, arranged a fire, fell into it and gave up their lives. The remaining infants, women folk and old men were escorted by Arjuna to Indraprastha. The city of Dwaraka was submerged in the sea in an instant.